The term myelodysplastic syndrome refers to a group of clonal stem cell disorders characterized by maturation defects that are associated with ineffective hematopoiesis and a high risk of transformation to AML. So, this should be clear to you. This is something in between frank leukemia and normal. There is some mutation that results in transformation of the cells. So, there is then clonal proliferation. So, these are different conditions we will discuss next. So, a group of clonal stem cell disorders, there is some mutation that results in clonal proliferation of some myeloid cells, and these cells are characterized by maturation defects. They are not maturing normally, and they are associated with ineffective hematopoiesis. These are maturing within the bone marrow, but they are also dying within the bone marrow. They are not coming in the peripheral blood. So this is ineffective hematopoiesis. And in these patients, there is a very high risk for the transformation to acute myeloid leukemia, to frank leukemia. In MDS, myelodysplastic syndromes, the bone marrow is partly or wholly replaced by the clonal progeny of a transformed multipotent stem cell that retains the capacity to differentiate into red cells, granulocytes, and platelets, but in a manner that is both ineffective and disordered. So you can say this is very compact knowledge in your book. I will try to explain this. If you remember, I have explained you, there is normal hematopoiesis within the bone marrow. There is erythropoiesis going on, myelopoiesis going on. Erythropoiesis will give rise to precursor or erythroid cells, then mature red cells. Myelopoiesis, this will give rise to precursors of myeloid cells, neutrophils, eosinophils, basophils, monocytes, and then the mature cells of all these series. This is myelopoiesis. At the same time, there is megakaryopoiesis going on. This will result in production of megakaryocytes. From the cytoplasm megakaryocytes, some fragments of the cytoplasm are separated and these are sent into the peripheral. These are the platelets. So all these are, all these cells are formed within the bone marrow. Now in this case, there is some transformation at the multipotent stem cell. If you remember the picture I have shown initially, so, how these cells are derived? Pluripotent stem cell, then maybe myeloid committed or lymphoid committed stem cell, then their progeny. So, differentiation is becoming more and more restricted. So, in these cases, there is some problem, some transformation at the early stage. Multipotent stem cell. So, this can differentiate into different cells. Maybe problem with the red cells, this can differentiate to abnormal granulocytes. So, this can result in abnormality in the platelets. Maybe one lineage or maybe more than one lineages. So, as a result, these cells are being produced, but this hematopoiesis is ineffective and disordered. So, the cells are produced, they are defective in nature, so many of these are destroyed within the bone marrow. So this is ineffective hematopoiesis. As a result, the bone marrow usually is hypercellular or normocellular, but the peripheral blood shows one or more cytopenias. So what will be the result of this? The hematopoiesis is going on within the bone marrow, but most of the cells are destroyed within the bone marrow, not coming to the peripheral blood. This is ineffective hematopoiesis. So when we will, in the peripheral blood, when we do CBC, we will see different types of cytopenias. Maybe patient is anemic, erythropoiesis is suppressed, that apparently means. Maybe low TLC, abnormal erythroid cell, we can see abnormal myeloid cell, neutrophils, other cell. Maybe problem with the platelets. So in the peripheral blood, we can see one or more cytopenia. There is one line, RBC or white cell or platelets, maybe one or more than one. These may be less in quantity. So this is cytopenia. But when we aspirate the marrow, so this marrow may be hypercellular or normocellular, because hematopoiesis is going on, but this is ineffective and disordered, so cells are dying within the bone marrow. The abnormal stem cell clone in the bone marrow is genetically unstable and prone to the acquisition of additional mutations and the eventual transformation to AML. Now there is some mutation, there is some transformation of the stem cell. So this is again some unstable cell. This can get more and more genetic changes, more and more mutations, and with the acquisition of more mutations, so this has a tendency to get transformation to AML. This will change to a frank leukemia. Most cases are idiopathic. We don't know the cause, but some develop after chemotherapy or radiation therapy. We are giving chemotherapy for some other tumor, breast cancer, lung cancer, some other thing, or we are giving radiation therapy for these patients of cancer of different types. So after some latent period, that may be in years, maybe 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 years, so after this treatment, we can see these myelodysplastic changes in these patients. This is therapy-related MDS. In some patients, we can see without any reason, there are some mutations in the genes and chromosomes, and that result in disordered abnormal proliferation of these cells in the bone marrow. So, morphology, you can describe this like, in MDS, the bone marrow is populated by abnormal appearing hematopoietic precursors. There may be some abnormal cells in the peripheral blood also, but bone marrow, this is more clear. Abnormal appearing hematopoietic precursors. These may be from different lineages. Abnormal erythroid precursors. We can see megaloblastoid changes. Changes like megaloblastic anemia, you will learn in red cell disorders. In megaloblastic anemia, we have erythroid precursors, which are larger in size from the normal counterparts, and there is some dissociation. There is defective DNA synthesis due to folate beta deficiency. So there is some dissociation between the maturation of nucleus and cytoplasm. So this results in the production of some larger cells. We call them megaloblasts. Erythroid precursors, which are bit larger than their normal counterparts, megaloblasts. So similarly, we can see these megaloblastoid changes, megaloblastic anemia-like changes in the bone marrow in these patients. Similarly, in erythroid precursors, we can see another change, ring sideroblast. We aspirate the marrow, prepare a smear, and then we do iron staining. This is some special stain, you can say. Prussian blue stain or iron stain, this is same, different name. The chemical used is potassium ferrocyanide. So in books, this may be written as iron staining, Prussian blue reaction, or Prussian blue staining, or potassium ferrocyanide. So after iron staining, we can see some ring sideroblast. These are nucleated red cells. Around the nucleus of these erythroid precursors, we can see there is mitochondria, and this mitochondria is containing iron particles. So these iron particles we can see in the form of a ring around the nucleus. So these erythroid precursors, which have these iron particles around the nucleus, these will appear as ring sideroblasts. The nucleus has a ring of iron particles around them. Similarly, abnormal granulocyte precursors with abnormal granules or nuclear maturation. So there may be some abnormalities in the granulocyte precursor, myeloid precursors. What may be the changes? There may be some abnormal granules. In the cytoplasm, there are fine granule, pinkish blue granules in the neutrophils, or there may be precursors. But these granules of the cytoplasm may be abnormal, maybe abnormally large. And there may be some changes in the nuclear maturation. And we can see abnormal megakaryocytes. Different abnormalities may be there. Normally there is one lobulated big nucleus, very big cytoplasm. So in these we can see maybe more than one lobe of the nucleus, or maybe two different nuclei in one cell of megakaryocyte. So there are different changes. These are abnormal megakaryocytes. So when the production of these hematopoietic elements in the marrow, this is abnormal, we can see different types of abnormalities in the peripheral blood also. When we will do CBC in these patients, different types of abnormalities may be there. Maybe some abnormal platelets, maybe giant platelets may be there, platelet count may be low, but still larger platelets may be there. Abnormalities in neutrophils may be only two lobes. This is known as pseudo-Pelger-Hued anomaly. Pelger-Hued neutrophils usually have two lobes, or no lobes, or like band forms, or only two lobes, not three, four, five lobes. So this is known as pseudo-Pelger-Hued anomaly. Similarly, different types of abnormalities may be there in the erythroid precursor, in the erythrocytes, maybe mature red cells. They have variable shapes. So these abnormalities may also be apparent in the peripheral blood, but no specific abnormality. Now, what are the clinical features? This is maybe a disease of old age, we can say. Most of the patients will present between the ages of 50 to 70 years. As a result of cytopenias, we have discussed this, there is disordered, ineffective hematopoiesis. This results in cytopenia. In the peripheral blood, different cells may be less. Red cells are less, mean anemia. White cells are, and neutrophils are less, mean neutropenia. So patient can present with the symptom related to anemia due to low hemoglobin. Patient can present with some symptoms due to neutropenia, repeated infections, fever, other things due to neutropenia. And patient symptoms related to thrombocytopenia, bleeding tendency, AP subcutaneous bleeding, bleeding from body parts, so hemorrhage from different body parts. So these are the symptoms related to thrombocytopenia. So variable picture may be there, variable symptoms may be there. Patient feels he has something abnormal but no specific disease, we can say. These are different types of presentations in these patients. Transformation to AML occurs in 10 to 40% of the patients. So this is quite serious. So in these patients, if these are untreated, so these can change to frank acute myeloid leukemia within some course of time. Prognosis is variable. Median survival time ranges from 9 to 29 months. So this may be variable in different subtypes of MDS. There is a classification of MDS. I will show you this here. Now this is from Essential Hematology. It is not necessary to memorize all this for you people. This is not given in your book, but you can understand this in a better way if some of you can memorize this. So this will be something very helpful. You can get more marks. You can give this reference. So this is WHO classification of myelodysplasia. So different types of presentations may be there for these patients. You can see this table. Subtype of MDS, what we will see in the peripheral blood, what we will see in the bone marrow, how much will be the blast percentage in the bone marrow, what is the relative proportion of these patients, how many patients belong to this category. So you can see this, you can discuss this here. It is up to you. If you can memorize, very good. Otherwise, not necessary to memorize this, but you will understand. MDS can present in different types. Now, refractory anemia with unilineage dysplasia. Then only one lineage involved. Refractory anemia, one type of MDS. In peripheral blood, we will see anemia. Refractory anemia means this will be resistant to routine treatment for anemia. We can give iron, we can give folate, beta, but this will not be responding. So, peripheral blood will show anemia. If we see the bone marrow aspirate, there is unilineage erythroid dysplasia, and main involvement of the erythroid precursors. Maybe more than 10% of the erythroid precursors are somewhat abnormal. But the blast count in the bone marrow, this is less than 5%. So blast in the bone marrow, we can say normally this count is below 5%. This means if we recognize the all nucleated cells in the marrow, erythroid precursors, myeloid precursors, different developmental stages of these cells, lymphocytes, macrophages, all these nucleated cells, and we do differential counting like DLC. We do this differential counting for bone marrow. This is known as myelogram. So normally the blasts, these are less than 5%. So there is some problem with the erythroid precursors, but blast count is less than 5%. So 10 to 20% of the patients of MDS can be belonging to this type of, this category, this type of anemia, refractory anemia. Next is refractory neutropenia. In peripheral blood, we will see neutropenia, less number of neutrophils. Again, in bone marrow, we will see unilineage granulocytic dysplasia, only granulocyte series, this is involved. There is abnormalities of the granulocyte precursors, but still blast count is less than 5%. So this is very rare, less than 1% of the patient may be like this. Then refractory thrombocytopenia. In peripheral blood, we will see thrombocytopenia, low platelet count. In bone marrow, we will see unilineage megakaryocytic dysplasia, only megakaryocytes are involved, they are abnormal, and the blast count in the bone marrow, that is still less than 5%. Again, this is not so common, this is less than 1% of the patient may be belonging to this category. Refractory anemia with ring sideroblasts. So I am explaining these things because in your book in morphology you will see these terms. Now here you can understand. Refractory anemia with ring sideroblasts. In peripheral blood we will see anemia, low hemoglobin. In bone marrow we can see unilineage erythroid dysplasia. If we do iron staining for this bone marrow smear, more than 15% of the erythroid precursors are ring sideroblasts. We can see iron particles around the nucleus after this iron staining. So these are forming a partial or complete ring around the nucleus of erythroid precursors. These are ring sideroblasts. Blast count is still less than 5%, so 3 to 10% of the patient may be from this category. Then refractory cytopenia with multi-lineage dysplasia. In peripheral blood we can see one type of cytopenia, and only anemia, only neutropenia, or maybe more than one lineages may be involved, maybe patient may be presented with anemia plus neutropenia or anemia plus thrombocytopenia. In bone marrow, we will see multi-lineage dysplasia. Erythropoiesis may be disordered, myelopoiesis may be disordered. We can see after, if we do iron staining in these patients, we can see ring sideroblast, or we cannot see ring sideroblast. So this may be positive or negative, but blasts are still less than 5%. No RRs. So RRs I have shown you in the acute myeloid leukemia myeloblast. In the neoplastic myeloblast, we can see these rod-like structures in the cytoplasm of the myeloblast. These are actually altered lysosomes. They condense together to make the structures. Only we see this in neoplastic myeloblast. So there are no RRs. Blast count is still less than 5%. Many patients may be belonging to this category. 30% of the patients of MDS may be belonging to this category. That means more than one lineage may be involved. Cytopenias, maybe anemia plus neutropenia, anemia plus thrombocytopenia. This may be there. Then another category, that is refractory anemia with excess blast type 1. Again in the peripheral blood we can see cytopenias. In bone marrow we can see unilineage or multilineage dysplasia. Blast count may be more than 5% but less than 10%. So 20% of the patient may be belonging to this category. Refractory anemia with excess blast type 2. Again we can see cytopenia in the peripheral blood and we can see unilineage or multilineage dysplasia in the bone marrow. And blast count is increasing more than 10%, 10 to 19%. And 20% of the patient may be belonging to this category. So if the blast count in the bone marrow, this is 20% or more than 20%, then we will label this case as AML. This is minimal criteria. Myelodysplastic syndrome associated with isolated deletion 5q. We can see in the peripheral blood anemia, or this may be no anemia, normal or high platelet count. So patient may be anemic but platelet count may be normal or high. So if we do karyotyping, we can see 5q3131 deletion. We can see anemia, hypolobulated megakaryocytes. Blast count is less than 5%. Less than 5% of patients may be belonging to this category. Childhood myelodysplastic syndrome. In this case, we can see pancytopenia in small children. If we do bone marrow, there may be multilineage dysplasia, disordered hematopoiesis in the bone marrow, but still blast count is less than 5%. So again, patients are very less in number, less than 1% patients may be belonging to this category. So this is WHO classification for the MDS. I have explained this so that you can be able to read your book more easily. What are ring sideroblasts, what are the megaloblast type thing. If you can memorize this, then of course this is good. Otherwise not necessary to memorize all these types. Now this is picture from your book. That is why I explained these things. I have given you this WHO classification. Now you can understand these diagrams better way. Myelodysplasia. Characteristic forms of dysplasia are shown. See picture A, top left. New created red cell progenitors with multilobated or multiple nuclei. You can see, I don't know if you can see this correctus arrow. No, these are red. This is a red cell with two nuclei. This is a red cell with two, red cell precursor with two nuclei. Red cell precursor with one nucleus. Red cell precursor with one nucleus. Red cell precursor with two nuclei. So this is abnormality in the erythroid precursors. Picture B, top right. You can see here ring sideroblast. Erythroid progenitors with iron-laden mitochondria seen as blue perinuclear granules. So this will be after iron staining, Prussian blue stain or iron staining. Now these are the ring sideroblasts. This is nucleus of erythroid precursor. Around this nucleus, these bluish spots, these are the actually iron particles. There is mitochondria around the nucleus. This mitochondria is containing these iron particles. When we do iron staining, then we can see these iron particles. Now these are forming a ring around the nucleus. So these are known as ring sideroblasts. So this we will see only after iron staining, not in normal gemcitabine staining. And see, lower right, pseudopalpebrate cells. Now these two, upper two, A and B, these are bone marrow slides. After bone marrow aspirate, we prepare the bone marrow smear, then we, this is gymnostain, A, upper left, and this B, this is a bone marrow smear after iron staining. Now this lower left, C, pseudopalpebrate cells, neutrophils with only two nuclear lobes instead of the normal three or four lobes. These are observed at the top and bottom of this field. This is two lobe neutrophil, this is two lobe neutrophil, bottom and top. This is peripheral blood smear. Should be clear this is. And you can see, and this is some immature myeloid cell. So there are different changes, morphology of the red cell is also changed. So you can see this type of picture in the peripheral blood.